Well, thank you for being here. I'm going to just be brief. I got to tell you though, it was wonderful coming in, driving in one of the most beautiful places I have ever. You know, I'm a native, but it's just beautiful every time I come up here at the town of Sonoma, driving in the mountain, the rings of vineyards. It's a glorious place. Thanks for putting this on, and this glorious building is also really wonderful walking through. Well, it's my honor and pleasure on behalf of Hospice by the Bay to introduce Dr. Steve Pantilat. And my main goal is that you understand that this is literally one of the few absolute preeminent palliative care physicians in the United States. And I'd like to just share personally, I worked at Highland Hospital in the East Bay, and we're an underserved public hospital. I was there for many years. This is about 15 years ago. So I'd like to call out that Dr. Pantilat and the team at UCSF were there for us. We didn't have any money, we didn't have any resources, but UCSF and Dr. Pantilat were there for us when it was our incredible pleasure to participate in one of the organizations, one of the many that Dr. Pantilat has helped start, the Palliative Care Leadership Center, and he is running one of the, UCSF may be one of the preeminent places to teach generations of physicians, and they let us attend for free. And we were then able to take that donation and build a program in Oakland, taking care of extremely diverse and underserved population. So, Steve, I didn't know that you'd ever know that that would redound, but I want to appreciate that. Dr. Pantilat has gone on to build so many programs and to support so many things institutionally, including being a tremendous leader that helped build and support Hospice by the Bay. And he serves on our board, and it's really critical that we're trying to build a system of care focused on the needs of all of you in the community, transcending hospice and palliative care and building around the needs of patients and goals of patients and making sure that we're there when you need it. So understand that at the same time as this guy is pulling off all this program building and national leadership and publishing, the stuff that actually means the most to me, he's also taking really good care of the patients he's taking care of. So one of the things you may see is when we needed a place to go to look at the way palliative care is supposed to be done to teach others, I went over to UC San Francisco and we actually made a movie he might talk about a little bit about that showed some of the care there. So Dr. Pantilat got it all. He's an internist, he's a palliative care, he's one of the leaders in the country. But if you also need a teacher or you need a physician to help take care of you and you want a wise voice, this is the man. Mm-hmm. So let us welcome Dr. Steve Pantilat.
Well, thank you, Jim. That was really delightful. Thank you for that. I really appreciate it. It's great to be with you this afternoon. why don't we start with some good news and bad news? All right, let's start with the good news. The good news is that there's never been a better time to be alive if what you want is to be alive, which is to say that after being really flat for 30,000 years of human evolution, lifespan in the United States has increased dramatically in the last 100 years. So in the year 1900, on average, we lived to be about 50 years old. And in 2018, we live on average to be 80. That is tremendous increase in lifespan over a very short period of time, due in part to good health care, due in part to clean water, vaccines, good nutrition. So that's the good news. So what's the bad news? Well, the bad news is that over the same period of time, the death rate has remained remarkably stable at exactly 100%. So that's the problem. Now, you didn't need me to tell you this. You already knew this fact. But what's hidden in this statistic is that while most of us will live longer on average, we will live part of that time with serious illness. For some of us, it may be months. For some people, it may be years or even decades living with cancer, with heart failure, with Parkinson's disease, with emphysema, cirrhosis, ALS, many different illnesses that we will have for years or decades. And that creates challenges for us as individuals, as family members and caregivers, and for us as a society. The challenge is, how do we live well in the face of serious illness? and how do we make sure that that time with serious illness is lived long and well? And that's what I want to talk about with you today and share with you some ideas about how we can do that for ourselves, for our loved ones, and as a society. The challenge, of course, is that when you get a serious illness diagnosis, you know, I think of it like this, like you're flying on a plane and it's nice and smooth and you have a drink and you're watching a movie. And then suddenly the plane drops 10,000 feet and there's an engine on fire. And that's what it's like when the doctor says, you have cancer, you have heart failure, you have Parkinson's disease. It's a shock. And you think in that moment that you're going to die, that the plane's just going to crash and burn on the ground. And while it feels that way, what we know is that there's actually a lot that we can do to help people live well in the face of that serious illness, in the face of that diagnosis, to essentially get that plane flying straight again so it doesn't just crash. Now, what's true is you're probably not going to just sit back in the back and watch your movie anymore. You're probably going to have to become a co-pilot on this plane. And the plane may not fly to the same place, and it may not stay aloft for the same amount of time. But we can get control of that plane and get it to fly smoothly. And what I want to talk about today is how we can do that to get that plane to fly smoothly again, and frankly, when it's time to bring that plane in for a smooth landing rather than crashing and burning. And the challenge is that there are some myths we have in society, the way we talk about illness and the way we think about the end of life that actually get in the way of good care. And so I want to share those myths with you, and then we're going to correct those myths. I'll tell you what the truth is behind it and how that can lead us to get good care. And so the first myth I want to talk about is this idea that you have to choose between quality and quantity of life. And often it sounds like this. Well, do you want to live, do you want to be comfortable and peaceful, or do you want to live long? As if those are two different choices that you have to make. And the idea is, well, if you want to live long, we know how you do that. You take all the interventions you can get, all the chemotherapy, and you have that pump placed in your heart, and you have surgery, and you have radiation. That's how you go to the hospital. You end up in the ICU. That's how you live long. Now, admittedly, that may be uncomfortable because a lot of those things don't feel so good, and they can make you sick, but that's how you live long. Or you might say, you know what I want is quality of life. I want to feel comfortable. I don't want to be in pain. I don't want all those interventions. And the idea is, well, if you choose that path, then you don't get to live as long. So you get to be comfortable, but live quite as long. And that's just a myth. And the truth is that you can have both. You can live well, and you can live long in the face of serious illness, and palliative care can help you do both. So I'm going to share with you a little bit about what palliative care is, how we define it, how we talk about it, how we provide, how we care for people who are receiving palliative care, and share with you a little bit of the data behind it that really makes this point that I think is really important to understand. Wow. All right. That's amazing. That's almost everybody. Wow. I would say, in most audiences, I get about half, and I would say about 10 years ago, nobody raised their hand. I'm amazed anybody came to a presentation like this 10 years ago, since they didn't know what I was talking about. So everybody knows, but let me give you a definition, the definition that I like to use, because I think it's really short and simple and really gets to the heart of the matter. That palliative care is medical care focused on improving quality of life for people with serious illness. That's what it is, in its most basic, simple idea. This is what I say when I talk with patients and families. This is what I say. You can find longer definitions. If you go online, the World Health Organization, the Center to Advance Palliative Care, you can get very long definitions, which are good, but they're too long. They take up too much time. This one is nice and simple. Two things I want to focus on here. One, this is for people with serious illness. What does that mean? Well, cancer, heart failure, emphysema, cirrhosis, which is liver failure, kidney failure, ALS, Parkinson's disease, stroke, those are all serious illnesses. What you'll notice in this definition is there's nothing about death or dying or end of life. It's not defined by that. It's defined by serious illness. That's who qualifies. It's focused on improving quality of life, asking the question, what makes for a good life? What makes for a good day? And how can we have as many of those as possible? Abraham Lincoln said, it's not the years in your life, but the life in your years that matters. And whether we measure life in years, or sometimes in months or weeks, the real question is, how do we think about having the best possible quality of life during that time? And the trick, of course, is that sometimes the medical interventions that are supposed to help you live longer and better are actually the ones that get in your way of your quality of life. And some of them actually help you have a better quality of life for longer. And so making those decisions is really the challenge, one of the challenges of serious illness. So let me show you what this looks like as a picture, because sometimes that can actually help us understand it. And this is sort of a picture of what it might look like, saying that at time zero, a patient is diagnosed with a serious illness, let's say cancer. This is my patient, Sam. Sam was 89 years old. He lived at home with his wife in a row house in San Francisco. Sam was a retired high school biology teacher in San Francisco. And one morning, Sam's wife called me and said, you know, I can't get him out of bed because his hip is really hurting. I can't get him out of bed. I said, well, don't do that. Just call the paramedics and bring him to the ER. So that's what they did, thinking maybe he had a hip fracture, which is unlikely to have happened just in bed overnight, but maybe that was it. And so they did an x-ray, looking for a hip fracture, no fracture. So they did a CT scan, because maybe there was a small little fracture that they couldn't see. So they did a CT scan, no fracture. He got some medicine for pain. He felt better. He was able to go home. But on the CT scan, they take some cuts of the, they go sort of above and below the area of interest just to make sure they get it all. And they got a few images of his liver that showed two masses in the liver that were concerning for cancer. Completely unsuspected, unrelated to his hip pain. So they set him up for a biopsy, and then Sam and his wife and his daughter came to my office for the results. And the biopsy showed that, in fact, he had cancer, colon cancer. So Sam and his wife and daughter sit down in my office. I said, you know, Sam, I'm really sorry to have to tell you this, but the biopsy showed that you have cancer, colon cancer, that has spread to the liver. Sam sat there for a moment, and then he had two questions right away. Can you imagine what he asked right away? How long do I have? Am I going to die? First two questions. Not, what are you going to do about this? Why didn't you find it sooner? Which is actually a perfectly good question for him to have asked. Am I going to die? How long do I have? Because that plane just dropped 10,000 feet, the engine was on fire, and he thought he was going to die. What was so interesting to me is that as we kept talking, it became clear that Sam thought he had about 2 or 3 weeks to live. I'm not sure where he got that idea, but clearly somewhere he got this idea, you get cancer and then you die. I thought he had probably about a year to live, given the stage of the cancer and his health otherwise. So when we talked about that, that was actually good news, because he thought he was going to die in 2 or 3 weeks, and I thought, what would have happened if he had left my office thinking he had 2 or 3 weeks to live when it was really about a year? And that's about how long he lived. What we know is that people have questions about their prognosis, about death and dying, right at the moment of diagnosis. And I would submit to you that's palliative care at the moment of diagnosis, being able to respond to those questions. Now, that doesn't mean you have to see a palliative care expert, doctor, nurse, social worker, chaplain with expertise, but your doctor or nurse or social worker or chaplain have to be able to talk to you about these issues when you ask that question. You can get the information that you want. So that's right here. Now, I did refer Sam to an oncologist. He did get chemotherapy. That means we had more focus on cure. The chemotherapy made him quite sick, so there was more focus on palliation, on treating the discomfort that he had, the nausea and the pain that developed. And this shows us that over time, either because it's no longer available, there is no more chemotherapy, surgery is not the right intervention, or because people say, you know what, I'm tired of those things. And I hear that from patients, like, you know what, I never want to see this hospital again. No offense, but I really don't want to come back here. And that happens. Palliative care plays a larger role in the care of patients. Hospice, I'm not going to say a lot about hospice. I'll say a couple things. One, hospice does require a six-month prognosis. The average length of stay is about 38 days. So even though it's, you can stay longer than 6 months, the referrals come really late. Half of people in hospice spend less, 18 days or less in hospice. And that's really unfortunate. If you are enrolled in hospice when you die, your loved one, your spouse, is less likely to die in the 18 months after you die. Think about that for a moment. Just think about that idea. Care that's received by the patient and the family around hospice not only makes care better for the individual who's sick, but it actually improves the health of their loved one afterwards. Very profound and important service. I also show here about bereavement that, you know, in healthcare we think about this idea of bereavement and about grief. We know that the kind of the pain of grief does get better in about 6 months, but it never goes away. And that's why I have this tail here that goes all the way off the slide. Some people say, oh, don't worry, you'll get over it. But of course, we know you don't get over the death of someone you love. It does get less painful, but we always remember. What I say is that our goal is to help you live as well as possible for as long as possible. And I often encounter people in the hospital and even in my clinic who get referred and don't know why. They don't know why we're there. I say, I'm with palliative care. And they kind of look at me. They're not quite as savvy as you are. And they kind of look at me and they say, well, what is that? I say, well, our goal, my goal is to help you live as well as possible for as long as possible. And they say, okay, you can stay. Why don't you sit down so we can talk about that? And that's the focus. So I'm going to share with you now one study. And I think if there's one study you should know in palliative care, this is the one that makes this important point. This is a study that was done at Massachusetts General Hospital by one of my friends and colleagues, Jennifer Temmel. In this study, they enrolled people with a new diagnosis of metastatic lung cancer. So what does that mean? It means lung cancer that is a new diagnosis but has already spread beyond the lung. It is not curable. And on average, people live for 9 months with that diagnosis, with treatment. So it is a very serious illness with a poor prognosis, even with treatment. They enrolled 151 people in this study at Massachusetts General Hospital at Harvard. Everyone in the study got standard chemotherapy, cancer care at Massachusetts General Hospital. So everyone got that, which apparently is very good, is what I've heard. I like to say it's not UCSF, but apparently Harvard is okay for your care. Half the people in the study then got, in addition, they got palliative care. They were randomly assigned to receive palliative care in addition. So that's the study, and then they looked to see what happened. So that's the study. And what did they find? People who received palliative care reported having a better quality of life. They also said they had a better mood. They were less likely to be depressed. They had less pain and less shortness of breath, so they felt better physically. They were less likely to get invasive care at the end of life. What does that mean? They were less likely to get chemotherapy in the last month of life when we know that it doesn't help. They were less likely to be in the ICU at the end of life, and they were less likely to be to have an attempt at resuscitation at the end of life, when in this setting of metastatic cancer, we know that it really doesn't work. Better health for loved ones. I already talked about that data with you from the hospice study. There are other studies that show similar outcomes. Less depression, less complicated grief for the loved ones if the patient has talked with the doctor and nurses about the kind of care they want at the end of life, if they've completed their advance directive, basically. Greater satisfaction with care, And most importantly, or just as importantly, they live just as long and maybe longer. In this study of people with lung cancer, the people who got palliative care, they lived on average 1 year compared to 9 months for people who didn't receive palliative care. Think about that. 3 months longer life and feeling better with palliative care. And now this study has been replicated in other diseases as well, helping people live better. There's never been a study, that shows that people who get palliative care live less long. So they don't always live longer, but they always feel better, and they live just as long. Based on this evidence and other studies like it, the American Society of Clinical Oncology, which is the world's largest cancer doctor organization, came out with a guideline, a recommendation in the last year that says that everyone with metastatic cancer should receive a specialty palliative care consult within 6 weeks of diagnosis. Because the evidence is so overwhelmingly positive. And in the guideline they write, there's never been a bad side effect from palliative care. Think about that for a moment. What other medical intervention has no bad side effects? None. I can tell you that, none. And I like to say, if it was a drug, everyone would get palliative care, right? That would be a company to invest in, I can tell you that. No side effects, and you live better and longer. That would be a pretty good medication. But it's obviously more complicated than that. It's a team of doctor, nurse, social worker, chaplain who you see in the hospital or in the office or on the computer. We now do telehealth visits to do that, or in your home, or in a skilled nursing facility. Unfortunately, it's not as widely available as we'd like it to be. And I think one of the challenges that we have is how to make it more available. It is available here in Sonoma Valley. Hospice by the Bay is one of the providers of that. It's available in the hospital here. It's available in the community. And so we're very fortunate to have access to that here. All right. So the myth that somehow you have to choose between quality and quantity of life, and the truth is that you can have both, and that palliative care alongside whatever other treatment you're getting from whatever doctors and nurses you're seeing is a way to make that happen, to live as well as possible for as long as possible. All right, so that's the first myth. Second myth, talking about what's really going on will destroy hope. So let's not talk about what's going on, okay? Because then there's going to be no hope. So let's not talk about cancer or what it means to have Parkinson's disease or dementia, because it's kind of a downer and it's going to destroy hope. I remember taking care of a woman in the hospital who had widely metastatic breast cancer, older woman, and her daughter met me outside the room. She says, "Don't tell my mom she has cancer." Okay. You know, she's been coming to the UCSF Cancer Center for 3 years. And the letters outside the building are about 10 feet high, and she reads. She knows how to read English. So I don't think this is a mystery that she has cancer. And she goes to that infusion center where everybody has cancer. So why would she be the only person in the infusion center without cancer? But people often know. And they still have hope. And the reason I say this is a myth is because what we know is that talking about hope actually encourages it. And so it's important for us to think about what is it that we hope for in the face of serious illness, and how can that help us lead a life that is as meaningful as possible and as good as possible in the face of serious illness. Serious illness can take away certain kinds of hope, but it can also encourage other kinds of hope for what can still be. We also know that hope is durable. You know, I've taken care of literally thousands of people with serious illness, many of whom have died. And what really strikes me and is really profound is that even very near the end of life, people still have hope. Hope might change, but it's still there. And if we talk about it, we can actually understand it, and we can encourage it, and we can support it. Because it's a very powerful part of the human experience to have hope. And yes, the hope for a cure may go away. That may not be possible, but many other hopes can exist at the same time. So what do people hope for? They hope for a lot of different things. They hope for healing, even if they're not cured. They hope for comfort in the face of suffering. And they hope for all the things that can be, despite all the things that cannot be. Well, what do I mean by that? So I was taking care of a woman, Sally. She had what's called interstitial lung disease. So that's a kind of chronic scarring of the lungs for which we have no cure. There are some treatments now that maybe slow it down a little, but there's no cure. Typically, people develop from the scarring a lot of shortness of breath, need a lot of supplemental oxygen, and it's about 2 years from diagnosis until people die. It's a very serious illness. Sally got admitted to the hospital at UCSF, ended up in the ICU with a pneumonia that made her breathing so short that she needed oxygen levels we could only provide in the ICU. She was pretty short of breath on very high levels of oxygen. And one morning on rounds, I said, you know, when we go in to see Sally today, we're going to ask her what she hopes for. Remember, the ICU team thought, yeah, I don't think we should do that. This is really dismal. I really, that's a bad idea. I said, no, we need to do this. So I went in and I said, you know, Sally, when you look to the future, what do you hope will happen? And she said, well, I want to be at my daughter's wedding. Well, that's really important. Tell us about that. She says, well, my daughter's getting married in 10 months up in Sonoma, as it turned out. I said, well, that's a beautiful place. Now, I'll be honest with you, I didn't think that she was going to live for 10 months, and I didn't think she would ever get out of the ICU. They said, well, that's really wonderful, but I'm worried that that may not happen. And so we talked about it as a team. We talked with Sally and her daughter said, well, that's fine. I'll just get married right here in the ICU. I said, okay. A few days later, that's exactly what happened. Her daughter came to the ICU in this beautiful white wedding dress. Her fiance was in a tuxedo. They put a corsage on Sally's hospital gown. Family, all the doctors and nurses, physical therapists, respiratory therapists, not a dry eye in the ICU. It was a beautiful wedding. Just what Sally hoped for. It wasn't the wedding she had imagined. But by asking what she hoped for, we were able to make that happen. I said it was a beautiful wedding. I will admit, I don't recommend it as a venue. Pretty expensive, for one. It's a little gross to be in the ICU. But it was really lovely, and it helped her achieve what was really most important. The other important message here is that we have to have the courage to ask about hope and not think that it's going to make people so sad. I mean, it does make people sad, but it also creates the opportunity for something really beautiful. So we have to have the courage to ask about it, and then we have to have the courage to be honest in our response. Because it would have been very easy, I'll be honest, to say, hey, Sally, what do you hope for? Oh, I hope to be at my daughter's wedding. Yeah, me too. I hope so too. From which she would assume, I told the doctor, and the doctor said, me too. He thinks I'm going to make it. That's really great. When I was thinking the exact opposite. What I tell my students and my fellows and my residents is, you got to ask this question, and then you have to be honest in the response. Compassionate, but honest. So have the courage and have the honesty to answer. What I would tell you is that if you get an answer that doesn't quite feel right to you, push the doctor on it. Because it makes some people uncomfortable to talk about still. But you have to get the honest answer so that you can make plans that are meaningful. So how do you ask about it? Well, I call these the golden questions. Golden because they are so valuable in how we think about serious illness. And I offer them to you, and I write about them in my book as well, because I think these are questions we can ask each other. These are not just questions for doctors and nurses and social workers and chaplains to ask patients. But these are the kinds of conversations we can have with each other. When you think about the future, what do you hope for? What's important to you? What do you value the most? When you think about what lies ahead, what worries you the most? These are opposite sides of the same coin. Right? What you hope for, that's what I want to have happen. What I worry about, those are the things I want to avoid. I worry I won't recognize my family. I'm worried I won't make it to my daughter's wedding. I worry that I won't be able to take care of myself. By understanding what we worry about and what we hope for, can help people have a good quality of life and know, understand what kind of quality of life might not be worth it. And to make the right decisions there. What you'll notice in these questions, there's nothing about death or dying. It's not about that. It's about living. But how do you want to live and what makes life worth living? So when Californians were surveyed by the California Healthcare Foundation, this was back in 2011, they did a survey of 1,000 Californians and asked them this question, what are the most important issues when you think about the end of your life? It's really interesting what comes out. So what are the things that people hope for? Make sure my family is not burdened financially by my care was the most common concern that people have, with good reason. Illness is the number one cause of personal bankruptcy in the United States. It costs a lot to be sick. So it makes sense that this is something people care about. And so thinking about what that implication is really important. Being comfortable and without pain is something people worry about. I hear this all the time. I worry I'm going to be in pain. And one thing I can tell patients with good certainty is that we know how to manage pain. That's something we can do. And the only point I will make here is that if you've been paying any attention at all lately to the news, you've heard about the opioid crisis in the United States, which is very real. But it is not because there are people who are dying of cancer using morphine. That is not the opioid crisis. And my worry is that we are going to begin to deny people with serious illness appropriate pain control because we're worried about the abuse problem. The abuse problem is real, and we absolutely need to deal with that. In the face of serious illness, we also have to provide compassionate care and pain relief. And often in the setting of serious illness, it's not possible to do it without using opioids, morphine, and related treatments. So my message is, in the face of serious illness, is to not be afraid of those medicines and to ask for them. And the thing that really worries me the most is increasingly now in our clinic, we are seeing people with serious illness who had been on opioids whose doctors say, I'm not prescribing this anymore. They're unable to distinguish between people with serious illness and other people who may not benefit. And that's a worry and I think something we all have to be aware of to make sure that we can have access to good pain control in serious illness. Being at peace spiritually is really important to people. That's why we have a chaplain on our team. That's why hospices have chaplains. They say there's no atheist in a foxhole. And that's probably right. It's what people think about. It's not just religion, but it's spirituality, it's meaning, it's legacy, it's what comes next. Important things to talk about. Making sure my family is not burdened by tough decisions about my care. How do you make sure of that? Zach, thank you. Advance directive. Otherwise, your family will be burdened by tough decisions about your care. Guaranteed. Because there will be tough decisions. There's no doubt about it. Things are not that easy. The more guidance you can provide to your loved ones, the less burdened they will be. In my book, I call that chapter The Gift. The gift you give your family when you're sick, one of the gifts is to tell them the care you want when you're sick. That they're not left there trying to guess, because it feels like a burden, making those life and death decisions for us, for someone else. And what I have observed is that in general, you probably get more care than you wanted, you get more invasive care than you wanted if you didn't tell your family otherwise. You're way more likely to end up in the ICU and on a ventilator and so on, unless you tell them that's not. So interestingly, living as long as possible, only endorsed by 36%. Which is not to say it's unimportant, It's just not the most important thing to the most people. But if you looked at our healthcare system, you might think that's the only thing that's important, trying to just keep people alive as long as possible. But that's not what people worry about. And so we kind of have the focus in the wrong place. That's what people think about, and that's what they hope for. All right. So the second myth is that we shouldn't talk about what's really going on, because that's just going to take away hope. And the reality is that talking about hope can help encourage it and help make it happen. Okay, so let's talk about the third and last myth that I want to talk about today, that somehow the goal is to have a good death. Maybe you've heard about this. People talk about this. You know, there's a good death. We want everyone to have a good death. One of my colleagues says, you know, the only good death is someone else's. I think that's right. I don't see this as my job. I do not think this is my job, is to help people have a good death. My job is to help people have a good life. And yes, at the end of life, can we help the end of life be peaceful and dignified and comfortable? Absolutely. And that is our goal. But that doesn't make death good. Because death is inherently sad, and it's filled with grief and loss. And I worry that in talking about a good death, what we're ignoring the sad, grief-filled part of death. I've never seen a death so good that people are lining up for it. Like, that sounds great. I think I'll do that instead. I think the language is what I have trouble with. Well, let me give you an example. This was Mary. Mary was 102 years old. When I met Mary, Mary lived alone in San Francisco. She cooked for herself. She took care of herself. 2 weeks before I met Mary, she had bought a new car that she was driving. And it was a Prius. And she was really proud that she bought this environmentally conscious car. She was very proud of that. 102. She was at home having lunch with her family. She collapsed at the dining room table. They called the paramedics, who came and whisked her off to the emergency room at our hospital. She wasn't breathing enough, so they put a tube down her throat, put her on a ventilator, a machine to breathe for her. They did a head CT scan, and they saw that she had a massive stroke, a bleed in the brain that was not survivable. It was at that point that they called the palliative care team, and we showed up, and that's when I met Mary. I came into the ICU, and I met her family, and I asked them about Mary, and this is when they told me this story about Mary. When they were done, they said, we heard the news. I said, yeah, I'm really sorry about that. They said, you know, she didn't want any of this. She doesn't want to live like this. Can you just stop all these machines? I said, absolutely. We can stop these machines, take good care of her. I think she will die peacefully. That is what we want. I thought to myself, you know, that's about as good as it gets. You live to 102 years old. You're completely cognitive. You're taking care of yourself. You're driving your own car. And you die in an instant. You don't even know you were sick. And then you're gone. Actually, some patients tell me even better would be to die in my sleep. That's what people tell me. I just want to go to bed one night and not wake up. I want to die in my sleep, which I think might be better, except for the person who wakes up in the bed next to you. I think that's a little creepy. I know that it happens. It does. It definitely happens. It's a little weird, but you can deal with it. So this is about as good as it gets. What really struck me was how much sadness and grief and loss was in the room. No one would argue that Mary did not have a good, long life. But her death was sad. And her family was grieving her loss. And they would have loved to have her around for 5 more years or 10 more years. And if in the best situation, there's still a lot of sadness and death, that's why I think that the goal is not to have a good death. It's to make it peaceful and comfortable, and that the goal is really to have a good life. And that is not as easy as it sounds. About a month ago, no, it's almost 2 months ago now, I saw a gentleman, he was in his 70s in my clinic, and he had heart failure. In order to feel somewhat comfortable, he had a continuous infusion of an intravenous medication to help his heart beat stronger. That's how weak his heart was. So he carried around a little pump that infused this medication. And I saw him before he had a pump placed in his heart, a left ventricular assist device, it's called. It's a pump literally inserted into your chest that helps pump the blood through your body. And there's a cable that comes out to a little battery pack. And said, you know, is this really what you want? He's like, yeah, I don't know, what choice do I have? This is it. Unfortunately, this was 2 months ago. He went into the hospital about a week later for surgery, survived surgery. I saw him a few times after that in the hospital. He died last weekend. He never left the hospital. I thought, wow, you know, was that the right thing to do? Was it not? I try not to second guess. It certainly seemed like the right thing to do at the time. But I think if we had it to play all over again, we probably would make a different decision had he known. But that decision in the moment is really hard to do. And so basing it on your values and what's most important to you is really the goal. And what was most important to him? And he said, you know what? I just can't go on like this. This is not a way I can continue. So either this path forward is going to help me out a lot or not, but where I am now is not working for me. But thinking about how we make good decisions is important. Now, having said that it's not about a good death, I'm going to ask everyone to just imagine for a moment the end of your life. Just imagine that. Where are you? Who are you with? What is it like? How many people had this image in mind? Anyone? No? It's the ICU at UCSF. No? Nobody? No takers? Not just because it's UCSF, right? It's just any ICU wouldn't work? Okay, fair enough. So that's not surprising that none of us would choose this. Nobody chooses this. Not for themselves and not for their loved ones. And yet, a third of Americans will die in an acute care hospital, often in a stay that includes time in the ICU. So why is that? Well, sometimes it's really legitimate. Like for Mary, we didn't know what happened. We thought maybe there was something we could treat. Turned out we couldn't. She ended up in the ICU. That's where she died peacefully. I think we took very good care of Mary. I think she had a very peaceful end. She was surrounded by her family. It was a very dignified, peaceful, comfortable end, even though it was in an ICU. But for most people, you see this coming from a mile away. People with advanced lung cancer. People with advanced Parkinson's disease, who have had really severe heart failure, and you know where you're going to end up. You're going to end up in the ICU, and you will die in the ICU unless you make a decision that's different, and you explain that to your loved ones. I want to take a moment just to read a little excerpt from my book. This is it's a little story about my grandmother, my Safta, It makes a nice point about quality and quantity of life. My Safta used to sign birthday cards with the wish that you should live to 120. Moses lived to 120 years. And a traditional birthday wish is that you should have a long life like Moses, the greatest teacher and leader of the Jewish people. But as she got older, my grandmother changed it just a bit. In Hebrew, she switched just one letter, and the change in meaning was profound. Rather than writing, live to 120, she wrote, live to 100 like 20. Live long and live well. My Safta understood that a good life is even more important than a long life. She lived that saying and declined chemotherapy when she was diagnosed with lung cancer at age 93. Not all of us will live that long, but we can all live the essence of that saying by living well. So, I talked earlier about the airplane. Here's the other image that we want to think about it towards the end of life, is to try and land, have a smooth landing. So often in medicine, we ignore the fact that every plane must land. And so we just keep flying around, and the fuel gauge is going down, and we're just flying the plane. And one of the engine goes out, and we're still flying the plane. And then, oh, surprise, there's no more fuel, and the plane crashes to the ground. And we're surprised by that. But we shouldn't be surprised. So the question is, after living a good long life, how can we bring the plane in for a soft landing? And that is possible to do. One of the challenges, and the last point I want to make before closing, is that there are things that we say as doctors and nurses that really get in the way as well. And I want to just kind of give you a warning about one of these things so you don't fall into this trap. And that is this question: would you like us to do everything possible? To which the answer is no. Well, okay, this is a sophisticated crowd. Usually the answer is yes, of course. I mean, can you imagine? You bring your mom to the emergency room, and the doctor says, would you like us to do everything possible for your mom? And you say, you know, for my mom, half would be plenty. I mean, really, it's fine. Don't knock yourself out. You know, my mom's a quitter anyway, right? I mean, really, no mom is a quitter, right? There's no such thing. And the problem, of course, is it's a terrible question. This is just such a terrible question. I always teach my students, do not ask this question. It's a terrible question. Terrible, really, for two reasons. One, there's really is only one answer. The answer is yes. And that may not be the right answer. That's one problem. The other problem with this question is that it's just a complete miscommunication. Because when we say that, we actually mean everything possible. That's what we mean. And have you been to a hospital lately? It's crazy. Dialysis, mechanical ventilation, heart pumps in your heart, organ transplantation. I mean, there is just, it is blows your mind what can be done to you. And I don't think in the ER when someone is sick and the doctor says, would you like us to do everything possible, that you're signing up for all of that, but we assume that you are. That's bad. I think what patients and families think is, yeah, everything that's going to help. Yeah, I want everything possible that's going to make me feel better. And so we're just completely miscommunicating. Let me give you an example. The woman that we took care of, she was 86 years old. She was at home with hospice. She had metastatic ovarian cancer. She was very close to the end of life. Chinese family, being taken care of by her family. Hospice at home. One morning, her daughter walks in to see her in the morning, and she doesn't look good. She's changed overnight. She's breathing only a few times a minute. She's moaning. It looks like, frankly, she's dying. But they panic. Instead of calling hospice, they call 911, which is really unfortunate. So the paramedics bring her to our ER, and the doctor says, would you like us to do everything possible? And the daughter says, yes. So the ICU doc says, all right, calls up the ICU, calls up the medicine team. We've got this patient. She's really sick. She probably has a big infection. You need to come down here and see her. We're going to intubate her. We're going to put in big IVs, give her antibiotics. So the doctor on call for the medicine team that day happened to be one of my colleagues, Steve McPhee. And he was also one of our palliative care docs. And he heard the story, and he hung up the phone and ran down to the ER, beat the ICU team, took the family aside, said, your mom is very sick. Yes, we know. And then he asked, how are you hoping we could help? And the daughter held up a shopping bag. She said, we brought new clothes because we need to dress her in new clothes for her journey to the next life. Well, that's really important. If that's important, we should do that right here in the ER, right now. But yes, that would be good. You know, she's very uncomfortable. We'd like to give her some medicine for that. Yes, thank you. And we have a room upstairs called a comfort care suite. It's very peaceful, and all of you can be with her. And we'll take good care of her. Yes, that's what we want. And that's what happened. She died 4 hours later, very peacefully, surrounded by her family. And the ICU team came screaming down to the ER, like, we got it. It's good. Go back to the ICU. She was this close to ending up in our ICU. It probably would have been day 3 or 4. It usually takes a while to figure these things out. Someone on rounds would say, what is going on? What is the matter with this crazy family? Don't they know? Yeah, they know exactly what's going on. We asked the wrong question, we got the wrong answer, and the patient got the care she didn't want. Now, I'm not suggesting that, so this is what I teach my students and my residents and my fellows, but this is what I would say to you. This is, don't answer that question. If you get asked it, don't answer that. You can't answer that question. Say, this is how we were hoping you could help. That's what you want to answer. You might end up in the hospital because you have a lot of pain or shortness of breath, and that may be the only place where you're able to get help in that moment. If they ask you that question, don't answer that. Just say, I'm here because I'm having a lot of pain, and I was really hoping you could help relieve my pain or my shortness of breath or my nausea or whatever it might be. You explain what's important to you, then you'll get the care that you really want, and you're not at risk of getting the care you don't want. So I show this painting. This is called The Doctor. Maybe many of you have seen it. It was painted by Sir Luke Fields in 1891. It hangs in the Tate Britain Gallery in London. It's a very large painting. I would say it's about this size, actually. Painted in 1891, Sir Luke Fields got a commission from one of his patrons who said, paint whatever you want. And he said, okay, I'm going to paint this painting. A painting that it's a very kind of honors this physician. And it was in honor of the physician who took care of Sir Luke Field's son when he was sick. But his son died. This is not in honor of the doctor because the doctor saved his son's life. And if you look at this painting today, you would say, there's nothing actually medical going on here. There's no IV pole, there's no antibiotics, there's no monitoring, he doesn't have a stethoscope. I mean, there's nothing. There's tea, which I think is for the doctor, actually, not for the patient. So what's going on here that's important? Why paint this painting? Because he's there. He's there. And it's easy to forget in our technological age that that's so important, that the doctor or nurse or social worker or chaplain is there with you in this in your illness. And I show this to my students to really make the point that, you know, who we are as human beings fundamentally matters to the kind of care that we receive and to feel cared for. And while you might excuse some things in your doctors and nurses when you're not that sick, I think when we are sick, finding someone who can walk that path with us is really important. I think that's one of the beautiful things that hospice is able to do, to actually be there with you in your home if that's where you need the care. I really love this painting, so when we were in London, I wanted to go see it in the Tate Britain Gallery. I was there with my sons, and at the time, the older boys were about 11. My youngest son was about 4. I said, okay, my wife was back at the apartment. I said, we're gonna go to a museum. And they're like, oh my God, no way. I'm like, no. Daddy needs to go see this painting. And they're like, they're really unhappy. I said, well, we're gonna see just one painting. And they're like, promise? I'm like, yeah, I promise. We're going to go see one painting. They said, all right. So we go to the museum. We get to the Tate Britain Gallery. I actually get a map so I can find out if I'm going to stick to my promise. And I find where it is, and we go through the galleries, and we show up, and we stand in front of this painting. And I just stand there, and I look. I'm like, wow. And my son looks at me and goes, we came to see this? Yeah. So to wrap up, you can live well and long with serious illness. Maybe not as long as you thought you were going to live, but nonetheless, may not be as bad as you think, but you can live well and long and longer than you might if you don't get palliative care. And palliative care can help you do both in the face of serious illness. Talking about what you hope for, it's important to talk about your hopes because it will help to encourage it and help you understand what is really most important. And finally, the goal is to live a good life in the face of serious illness. And yes, at the end of a good life, of a life well lived, can we help the end of life be peaceful and comfortable and dignified? We can. But that's not the goal. The goal is to live a good life. And I want to end by giving you a quiz. Did they tell you about the quiz? They didn't, yeah. I saw you weren't all taking notes. I noticed that. I'm giving you the easiest quiz you've ever taken in your whole life for two reasons. One, you don't have to write anything down. And two, I'm not going to grade you. So it's an easy quiz. What I like about the quiz is that it makes the point about the importance of caring and how we care for each other, especially in the face of serious illness, and how important caring is when we're sick. Okay, so you don't have to write anything down. You don't have to say anything. You just follow along. Name the five wealthiest people in the world. Name the last five Heisman Trophy winners. Name 10 people who have won the Nobel or Pulitzer Prize. Name the last half dozen Academy Award winners for Best Actor and Actress. Name the last decade's worth of World Series winners. How'd you do? Terrible, right? Think about it. These are no second-rate achievers. These people are the best in their fields. But the applause die, awards tarnish, achievements are forgotten. And I'm going to give you another quiz. We'll see how you do on this one. List a few teachers who aided your journey through school. Name three friends who have helped you through difficult times. Name five people who have taught you something worthwhile. Think of a few people who have made you feel appreciated. Name half a dozen heroes whose stories have inspired you. Easier? Sure. The lesson. The people who make a difference in our lives are not the ones with the most money, the most credentials, or the most awards. They're the ones who care. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Doctor.
Yeah.
So we're going to do some Q&A, and I have one microphone, so if you can raise your hand, I'd like to be sure that everyone hears the question. Are there any questions?
Would you explain the difference between palliative care and hospice?
Yeah, great question. So what's the difference between palliative care and hospice? So this is how I explain it. Palliative care is care focused on improving quality of life for people with serious illness. And there are many ways to deliver and to receive palliative care. Hospice is one way. Hospice in the United States, at least, is a particular kind of service defined largely by a benefit that people get in Medicare that's been adopted by other insurers as well. It requires a 6-month prognosis and a serious illness, some other things. Largely a service delivered at home by a team of doctor, nurse, social worker, chaplain. So that's hospice. Hospice is one way to get palliative care. It's actually probably the most common way to receive palliative care. It is available in every community in the United States. But that's hospice. But there are many ways to get palliative care. You can get palliative care in the hospital. You can get it in the clinic. You can get it. We're doing it now over the internet. Does that help? Good question.
Hi. I had one of those airplane flights in the fall.
I'm sorry.
Thank you. And my sister came and heard you after the Santa Rosa fires. And she's a hospice nurse, and she picked up one of your books and brought it down to San Diego. I want to thank you for it. Because of that, I do have a palliative care doc. Death and dying is not something that our family shies away from. My husband died after 14 months in hospice 5 years ago. And I did live longer than 18 months past his hospice death.
There you go.
So I just want to thank you for that. I think we don't do a good job in general. I had a surgeon who didn't want to hear that. If I had a heart attack, I didn't want to be resuscitated. We worked through that, because I was able to be consistent in my message. And in the meantime, I think a lot of nurses on the floor were educated that it's okay for the patient to have a voice. So that was pre-getting the book. Getting the book did cause me to seriously think about asking about prognosis, kind of putting the doctors to the point of having to speak honestly. And it And they do, is my understanding, for anybody with diagnosed with a serious illness in this hospital group, they do have a palliative care doc visit.
Right.
I was kind of clueless when I guess that happened. So when I went back and asked, and so like my daughter who's been the 23-year-old who's been the caregiver, she's on a online caregiving group and she said, everybody ought to have a palliative care doc. And the social worker said, Brianna's got a great idea.
That's so great.
Thank you very much for what you do.
Yeah, I'm sorry about your illness, but thank you for sharing that. And I'm glad you're getting palliative care. It's really good. And I just want to say thanks to your daughter for sharing that. I mean, I think that's the other thing we can do is that, you know, as I mentioned earlier, palliative care is not as available as we need it to be. And we're working on that. I'm trying to make it more available, trying to teach all doctors and nurses how to provide the basics of palliative care. But part of it is that we all in our society need to demand it. You know, if you go to a hospital and they don't have it, you got to ask for it. And you say, where is it? Write a letter to the CEO. Pick up the phone and say, hey, where's the palliative care team? What's with that? And if your doctor says, no, you're not ready for palliative care, which I hear a lot, which basically means you're still alive to a lot of doctors, you have to say, no, I understand what it means, and this is what it is, and this is why I want it. And I think as we demand it in our society, we will provide it more. And the analogy I will make is to birth. So if you think about birth 40 years ago, mothers were in an operating room sedated, fathers were in a waiting room, and then a baby showed up sometime later. And that is not how my kids were born, I'll tell you. That's probably how I was born, but that is not how my children were born. That changed not because doctors and nurses thought the old system was bad. That's not why we changed. We changed because patients, mothers and fathers said, this is not the way we want this experience to be, and you better change, or we're going to go find the place that does it the way we want it. And I think we have a lot of power as consumers of healthcare to change the healthcare system. Yeah.
So what would you recommend? I had a mother that had a little bit of dementia prior to her passing, and I struggled with my family would not talk to her or ask her what she wanted because they thought, of her dementia, she wouldn't have the ability to answer, but I disagreed, of course. But what would you recommend for people who maybe have slight dementia before they enter this life-threatening illness and how to get their thoughts to the doctors?
There's no way to know other than to ask. I mean, you get a sense of how someone is thinking by talking to them about other things. So you can get a sense of how they're thinking. But you can ask questions like, you know, Mom, when you look to the future, what do you hope will happen? And if she talks about things that make sense to you, they make sense. Particularly if they're consistent with the way she was earlier in her life. You know, if she was someone who never went to the doctor and suddenly she says, you know, I want to go to the hospital and I want everything done for me forever. You're like, maybe that's the dementia talking a little bit, or vice versa. I think certainly if things are consistent and if she can answer questions like that, which I think are a much easier way to introduce the topic than to actually begin by talking about death and dying, although you may still want to get there. You know, what are you worried about, Mom, when you look to the future? She may tell you things that are, you know, even people with moderate dementia can still be very cogent about the things that worry them and the things they hope for.
We're here?
I have two questions that relate. I actually just got back from a palliative care conference down in Orange County. It was wonderful.
Coalition first, meeting?
I'm sorry?
Were you at the coalition meeting?
Yeah, the Coalition for Compassionate Care.
Yeah.
And the question I have is, first of all, do you need to have a kind of diagnosis to get palliative care? I asked a question of one of the docs down there about neurodegenerative diseases like MS and Parkinson's. And my father had Parkinson's, and he didn't qualify for palliative care. They had said to us that you have to show a consistent decline that, you know, so I wanted to ask that question. And the second question is, do we have community-based palliative care, which means that a palliative care team, like a hospice team, will come to your homes? Do we have that yet in California? And if not, do you perceive that it will be happening?
So two good questions. So neurodegenerative diseases certainly qualify for palliative care. There is a particular qualification, a six-month prognosis that is required for hospice referral. But for palliative care, a diagnosis of Parkinson's disease, MS, and related disorders, absolutely. ALS, absolutely. We have a clinic now set up at UCSF within our Parkinson's disease and movement disorders clinic and a project that we're doing. I will say that there's still a lot of misunderstanding about those kinds of illnesses and about what happens to people with those illnesses. I think there's still a perception, a teaching out there that people don't die from Parkinson's, they die with Parkinson's disease, for example. I think that was true when people died in their 60s and they got diagnosed at 62 and they died at 65. They didn't live long enough to die of their Parkinson's, but now people do. And so Parkinson's is the 14th leading cause of death in the United States. So definitely those illnesses do qualify for palliative care. Do we have home-based palliative care in California? Yes, we have a lot of home-based palliative care in California. Not as much as we need, but we have a lot. And I would say that in Marin, Sonoma County, they're actually providers of home-based palliative care. Hospice by the Bay, Calabria Care, both offer home-based palliative care. Up, if you go farther north, Resolution Care, Yolo Hospice, Snowline Hospice, and Sacramento region, UCSF, we provided. So lots and lots of providers up and down the state, and it's growing. Blue Shield of California is growing home-based palliative care. HealthNet is growing home-based palliative care for their clients. So yes, not as much as we need, but it's growing. Sonoma, yes, I think you can get it here, yes. Yes, yes, please.
Yes. I'd like to ask if you could do a scenario for Mary, the 102-year-old, and the Chinese lady, if they had a post that said comfort care only, how would that have played out? Because I think that's important for people to understand that option and how that works.
Yeah, so pulse form, physician order for life-sustaining treatment, is a really good thing to have if what you want is care that's not do everything possible to me. So it's important to have one of those. There they are. Wow. Imagine that. That is amazing. There's a pulse form in the flesh right there. A whole stack of them, actually. One for everyone in the room. How would it have changed? I think for Mary, if she had done that and her family saw it, then when she collapsed at the dining room table, they would not have called paramedics. I think they would not have called. And I think at that point, they might have just called the coroner. So I think she wouldn't have made a trip to the ER, to the ICU. Well, you know, she probably had a pulse form that said that. I think what happened there is her family kind of panicked. And in the last moment, they called 911 when they should have called hospice. And I think that's just more education. This happens sometimes, is that people enrolled in hospice, and there's, you know, commonly there's like the hospice phone number, you know, all over the wall so that people get it right, but people do freak out, and they don't know what to do, and they call 911 by mistake. We always tell people, if you have a question, if there's something urgent, if something happens you don't understand, please call hospice. I think if they had called hospice, that's what they would have gotten. Hopefully, if there had been a pulse form that reflected that and the paramedics had come and seen that, that would have been an opportunity to ask the question, you know, why are we here? Because you have this pulse form. And then, I'll be honest with you, it is a conversation in the moment. And if they could have managed it there and really clarified it, called the hospice, they might have been able to avoid that whole trip to the ER. Totally. Yeah, you know, I think, again, I'll tell you, I think in practice it's still a conversation. You know, they would say, hey, I see there's a pulse form here. It looks like your grandmother, your mom, didn't want to come to the hospital. I'm not sure what happened, but, you know, it looks like whatever was going to happen, and maybe the paramedics would have a conversation. And honestly, in that situation, maybe they wouldn't.
But it's very likely the paramedics would transport her with that pulsed form.
Correct.
To inform the providers
right.
at the emergency department what the yep. plan of care had been established was, so it wasn't a mystery
Correct.
At that point.
and at least you have a hope of getting the care you want. Or without the pulse form, you have no hope of it at all. And I think if Mary had had that conversation with her children to know that and said, by the way, I just signed this pulse form with my doctor, and this is what it means, and if I, you know, collapse at the dining room table one day, let me be. The most important thing is not to just have a form sitting somewhere, but to have that conversation with the people who are going to be there to make that call in the moment. That's what you really, really need. The form backs it up, but that's what you need, that conversation.
We're going to take two more. Two more questions.
Yeah. It's a good one, sorry. I don't want to embarrass you, Dr. Middleberger, but I'll do my best. So I just have a question. You mentioned without palliative care that the spouse is, or loved one is likely to pass within 18 months post the death of the loved one. But are you, so I just want to make sure I'm hearing this right. You're saying that the grief from loss is greater than the stress that you feel, you know, the stress you have in the day-to-day routine, because that impacts the body in such a way that a person just gives up or they shuts down. I mean, is that what you're saying in so many words?
So what the evidence shows is that if you are in hospice compared to not being in hospice, your loved one is less likely to die in the 18 months after you die. So that's technically what it's saying. And I think that's different than saying that, you know, you're not likely to die. You may still die, but compared to a similar cohort of people where they're similar, they're less likely to. And I'll be honest, I don't think we know exactly why that is, but I think all the things you said are probably right. I mean, the stress of losing your spouse is really intense, you know, particularly if you've been married a long time. I mean, there's, you know, sad, and it's really stressful. Caregiving is stressful, loss is stressful, and people respond in different ways, and depression and complicated grief are not uncommon in that situation, and those are risk factors for dying. Also, we know that people who are caregivers don't take care of their own health. They don't go to the doctor, and they don't get the things they need because they're taking care of someone else who's sick. And so I think there's a lot of factors that kind of fit in there. And it's interesting to think, what is it about hospice services that changes that dynamic, right? That makes it less stressful, that gives you the opportunity to take care of yourself and your own health at the same time.
Hi. I have a father who's 97. He's in a board in care. He's not sick. He's just very old and needs 24-hour care. I have a brother who's 65, who has MS, and he's bedridden. And there's no prognosis or diagnosis for how long he's going to live.
Right.
I was diagnosed with breast cancer. And luckily, I'm 4 years out, and I'm doing really well. What I'm curious about is palliative, like, none of us have a prognosis, or what do you call it? Is that right? How long we're going to live.
Right.
To me, palliative care sounds like what I've been trying to do through, like, Cancer Support Sonoma, is take care of myself, make sure that my life is better with serious illness. But, like, with someone like my father and my brother, like, is there, like, do they have to have some kind of, they're in Fresno, you know, in that area, some kind of prognosis where they could go and talk to someone, or do they actually have to have, like, a diagnosis and say, you know, and I'm trying to make...
Yeah. Well, that's a great question. I think if you're 97 and you want to get some palliative care, you get to get it. Particularly if you're frail, living in assisted living, caregiving. I think, you know, frailty, we know, is a life-limiting condition. So I think certainly that would qualify. Whether you need a monthly or every 2 month visit with a palliative care team, that maybe not. But I think addressing certainly an advanced care plan, an advanced directive, absolutely your dad should have one. I think we all need one, but certainly if I were 97, I'd want to make sure I had mine. So I think that would be true. So I think that's really important. There may not be a lot of urgent issues to take care of, but I would certainly make sure that was taken care of. I guess I would say the same thing for your brother. I think MS is can be a very open-ended diagnosis, which can cause a lot of disability, but people can live for a really long time with it. nonetheless, there are sort of predictable complications. And so you can anticipate what those might be, infection. I mean, there are some things that you can sort of think about. And then, you know, my quality of life such that I want those things treated and I want them treated in a particular way. And, you know, I think all you can have those conversations. Again, I think an advanced care plan is, advanced directive, really important there. And I think in the setting of, you know, what we now call survivorship, meaning I've been through my cancer treatment and I'm kind of out at the other end and things are looking good, what's the role of palliative care there? We're trying to figure that out. I'll be perfectly honest. I don't think we know. We don't have enough palliative care docs to see all the people who are still going through treatment and who have the serious illness. So I think it's an open question. We definitely see some patients who go through their chemotherapy and are still either having symptoms or want to continue to visit with the palliative care team maybe once a year, and we continue to do that. But I think the luckily, the issues are way less urgent in that setting, which is a good thing. You're welcome. Yep. Thanks a lot. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you very much. So I want to again acknowledge the volunteers from the hospital, all you guys, thank you. From Hospice by the Bay and from Elder Resource for helping us set up the room. I know there are several here that are going to be participating in the workshop, so we need to rearrange the room to take advantage for the Advanced Healthcare Workshop to follow. If you haven't signed up, you're more than welcome to attend. Dr. Pantilat is going to be over here. We have some books of his. He's available, so you can have some more conversation with him. The books are $15 a piece, and thank you so much for coming today.